welcome to New Review, and today we'll be reviewing the characters from the Netflix series Sense8. This series follows 8 individuals who are psychically and emotionally connected to one another and come from vastly different backgrounds and different locations on the Earth, and each have their own understanding of the world, different beliefs, and they all come together through this ability that they have to connect to one another on an emotional and psychological level. And now the main 8 is the ones that we'll be focusing on, and they are Cepheus, Sun, Wolfgang, Kala, Leto, Nomi, Will, and Riley. These are the main 8. These are the August 8th cluster, and I will try to review them in that order because in this way, it's looking at them in the pairs that they kind of needed each other in to kind of build their characters from where they were. Now, the first of these is Cepheus. Cepheus is from Nairobi, Kenya, and works as a Matutu bus driver. He lives in the slums of Nairobi and is trying to make enough money to make sure that his mother has the medicine that she needs, as his mother currently is suffering from HIV. Possibly has AIDS. That isn't really established, but what we do know is that he really cares for her and is trying to make sure that she has what she needs. And that's really something important about Cepheus's character. No matter what his needs are, he's trying to look out for everyone else's needs. His friend Jala, he's trying to make sure that he has what he needs to support his family. And when he's brought into Silas Kabaka, a drug lord from Nairobi, when he's brought into Silas Kabaka's employ, he tries to make sure that Kabaka's daughter, Amori, has what she needs, because much like his mother, she is sick, and Silas is using Cepheus to make sure that she gets the treatment that she needs so that she can survive. And while that is one of the most important parts of Cepheus's character, another important part is his wisdom. Unlike any of the other characters from Sense8, Cepheus seems to be the wisest of his group. Not that any of the other characters didn't have some wisdom to impart on other characters. Cepheus seemed to have the most wisdom to impart and did it much more consistently throughout the series. Granted, he only spoke to really Riley and Kala and Sun to impart wisdom on them. He still had the most profound wisdom to give to them. With Kala, he taught her about how while a bed is important, it keeps you where you are, whereas the entertainment of a flat screen takes you to a possibility and takes you to a place where you don't have to think about your struggles. With Riley, he's trying to teach her that yes, pain occurs, but we have to use the pain to grow and to mature as a person. And with Sun, it's how important family can be and how important keeping your word is. And he really has the closest connection with Sun, as he visits her more often than any of the other Sense8s in his cluster. And that connection is very important, because connecting with Sun the first time is what gets Silas Kabaka's attention, because as he's trying to make sure that he gets enough medicine for his mother to live, it gets stolen from him by a street gang called Superpower. And when he uses Sun's abilities to beat the crap out of some of the members of Superpower, he gets Silas Kabaka's attention, which leads him to employ him as a courier for his daughter, who is sick with leukemia. And using the experience that Cepheus has with his mother and how much he cares for her and how much he wants her to live, he is used as the person to ferry Amori, Silas Kabaka's daughter, to a WHO facility because Superpower would use their knowledge of Silas's cars to get to Silas. And then near the end of the series, when Silas is captured and Superpower wants to use his daughter to hurt him, he reaches out one last time to Sun and uses her experience, her knowledge, to fight out of a bad situation, even though we clearly see how painful it is for him both before and after the fight. And with his connection with Sun, he also grows as a character and starts to wonder about his safety, what is important for him personally. And while he still does care about other people, and he still has that as part of his character, he is a little bit more self-aware of his needs and his wants by the end of the series. Now the other the next main character that we're going to discuss is Sun. Sun is from Seoul, South Korea, and she works at a business, the business that her father made, as the vice president and chief financial officer. And when we first meet her, she's an angry and closed-off character. And we see this anger when she's trying to speak with her father about something that she's been looking at. We don't exactly know what she's looking at, but what we can tell is the financials of the company that she works at, and there's something going on. And when she's trying to get a meeting with her father, and she's talking to her father's assistant, she's rebuffed, and we see her clench her fist in anger. And when the assistant asks if she has a message, she punches the assistant's desk and takes a good chunk out of the wood in the desk. And she doesn't seem to really be fazed by punching the desk, but she does seem angry. And beyond smoking a cigarette, we really, up until the second or third episode, seen her relieve stress in a positive or constructive manner. And then she goes to a South Korean underground kickboxing ring, where she kicks ass. For the first few moments, after being identified as a skinny bitch, because she's a very small character, she's physically, she's thin, she's short, she doesn't look like much of a threat when you would think about fighting her. And we see her do very well, not really put any effort behind dodging or taking him down. And when she, after being distracted for a little bit, she just destroys him. And as we're learning about her abilities to fight, which are impressive, we're also learning a little bit about her background. Within her family, she's not really been paid attention to by her father, and her father was more worried about her brother, her younger brother, Junki. And the person who really paid attention to her, really seemed to care about her on a much more visible level, was her mother, who died of some illness when she herself was very young. And part of the last thing she said to her mother was that she would look after her little brother, Junki. And Junki, what we learn about him is he's not really that concerned about doing what he's supposed to do. One of the biggest scenes we have with him is him in an underground sex club and having a lot of fun instead of doing what he's supposed to be doing. And we learn that what Sun has been looking at through in the financials is embezzlement. And we learn that it's Junki who's been doing the embezzling. And he's scared and he doesn't want to go to prison. But Sun has a way out, and even though she has a way out, she questions whether or not she should do it because she doesn't really have a connection to her brother beyond blood. What she feels is an obligation. And yet Kafius, using his wisdom, shows her that it's something that she has to do. That obligation is just as important, and that having concern for others is something that is important. And she goes through the legal system of South Korea. She turns herself in, taking the fall for someone else who she doesn't seem to care about, but has the truest obligation to fulfill, because someone she did care about asked her to make sure that she looked after this person. And while she's in South Korean women's prison, she finally makes connections. She makes a connection with every woman in her cell, and she's able to connect on a personal level because she had a bad life with the men in her family and her life, and so did all of the women that are in prison with her. And she then eventually stands up for one of her cellmates and is able to experience the prison yard. And in the prison yard, they're allowed to paint, and they all paint things that are very happy memories for them. The woman she stood up for, Soo Jin, is painting her memory of her with her sisters, which was a happy time for her. And then Sun, she paints a picture of her with her mother, which was a very happy time for her. And we see her kind of lighting up and growing as a character. And that really increases our understanding of her and increases our empathy towards her, which is something that grows when her father comes in and says that he'll tell the truth and she'll be released and Jun Ki will go to prison. And the next time we meet someone from outside the prison after her lawyer, it's her brother. And her brother informs her that their father is dead, and she puts two and two together that her brother killed her father. And even though she hadn't really had a connection with her father up until him saying that he'll tell the truth, she created that connection so quickly that when that was severed by her brother, she goes berserk, which I would say is natural. And even though Jun Ki is her brother, she says that she will get him for what he did because she felt a connection with her father that she hadn't had before, and we all hoped that it would continue to grow, but because it was cut off, we can't really see that. And that connection that she was gaining with her prison mates, with her father, wouldn't have been catalyzed if she wasn't a sensei, wasn't part of the cluster she was with Cafius and with the others that she meets, because she's able to gain a connection with Riley with one meeting. She's able to gain a connection with Kala with one meeting. She's able to impart onto Kala some wisdom, and she's able to understand a bit of Riley, and Riley's a bit able to understand a bit of Sun. Now the next characters are Wolfgang and Kala, the two biggest star-crossed lovers on the series. But first, let me just talk about Wolfgang for a bit. Wolfgang, when we meet him, he's kind of this roguish thief character who's involved in organized crime. Now, even though he lives in Berlin, Germany, we learn that through hints that he is a transplant, that his ancestors are Russian, and that they moved sometime after World War II and lived in East Germany. And he has. Doesn't really have a lot of friends, doesn't really connect with his cousin or uncle, but he does connect with Felix, and we later learn that he views Felix as a brother. And Felix is really important to him because Felix was the first person who actually accepted him for who he was. And his father, the first time we meet him is his father's grave, and he pisses on his father's grave, which shows that there's some antagonism. There was antagonism between him and his father. And Wolfgang is a safecracker like his father was, and he wants to stick it to his cousin Steiner, and so he steals from under his nose the diamonds that Steiner was going to steal. And he does it by cracking a safe that his father got caught trying to crack. Now, when we first see it happen, we're not sure as to why. It's probably possible that he used Riley's ability, of understanding pitch and tone to crack the safe, which had been viewed as uncrackable. And as the series progresses, we see him, while he does care about his friend Felix, he's kind of a selfish, self-centered character. He wanted to prove to himself that he could do it. He wanted to prove that he was the best safecracker in his family. And this man is a very intelligent man. He's also a very good fighter, which we see a little bit of. And when he meets Kala, it's the best line that we can describe it as is from his own words, that the moment he saw her, he knew he wanted her. And they just seem to connect almost instantly the first time either of them connect. It's his experience that's being transferred to her in a rainstorm. And this connection continues to be present the entire time. They almost exclusively visit each other. And as this, at first it starts out, he's like a demon or some sort of curse. And then as it goes on, they have a much deeper connection. They try to understand each other and Kala. And he comes to love Kala, and it's on a very deep level. He cares for her well-being as much as he cares for his own well-being, as much as he cares for Felix's well-being. And by the end of the series, he's trying to sever that connection because he feels that he doesn't deserve the love. He doesn't deserve having someone like Kala, he thinks, because he views himself as a monster, like he viewed his uncle and his father as a monster, which is important because he killed both his father and his uncle, who he viewed as monsters, and ostensibly he viewed his cousin Steiner as a monster, because with the help of Leto, he needed Leto's help because he couldn't lie to Steiner, who reminded him of his father. He killed Steiner as well, and ostensibly since Steiner reminded Wolfgang of his father, ostensibly Steiner was also a monster. And now Kala is a very intelligent and caring woman. She's a pharmacist from Mumbai, India, and she is a very religious woman. She prays regularly and brings offerings regularly to the elephant-headed god Ganesha. And her first prayer to Ganesha is about her upcoming wedding. She says he's a handsome man, he's well suited for her, they're a good match with each other, but she doesn't love him. And the first connection she has with any of her sensate cluster is with Wolfgang. She hears the rain that he's surrounded by when he's having sex. She physically feels hotter. And the first time they see each other, which is right after he's had sex and he's eating Indian food, which is another connection that they had, she sees him, and he knows that not only did he want her, but he knew that she wanted him. And she's trying to deny it. Like, she has this duty to marry the man that she agreed to marry because it was a love marriage, which would be the first in her family, and probably the first in his family, even though his father didn't really believe. Rajan is the man that she was going to marry. Anyways, as the series progresses, she becomes more and more connected. She explains her faith to him, and it does it in a way that is understandable for someone who doesn't believe. And it creates a very, very deep connection. However, the real catalyst for a deep connection, I think, was from the scene in What's Up, where the entire cluster sings "I Said Hey, What's Going On" by Four Non-Blondes, and they're the only two that sing it to each other. She appears to him while he's singing in the karaoke bar, and he appears in her dream and in her bedroom, and they're singing it together, and it's a very touching scene. And they almost kiss several times, first during the karaoke scene, next during the discussion of faith and religion and science. And they don't really kiss until the end. And in the e near the end, when Wolfgang goes to confront his uncle, she wants him to turn around. She wants him to not do it. But when he does, she starts to break down, like she's going to lose someone she truly loves. And then when Sun teaches her that she needs to fight for what she wants, when Wolfgang appears to say goodbye, she helps him fight by making a bomb for him. And by doing so, it's kind of showing that, yeah, you're willing to fight, so am I. And in the end, when she's told that Wolfgang is a monster by Wolfgang, we see that she doesn't really want to accept it. And in the beginning of the series, much like Kafka, Kala seems like someone who's wanting to please others, who's wanting to make sure others have what they need. And then by the end of the season, we find that she's starting to realize that she needs to have something that she wants as well. And she needs to accept that she has needs of her own. The next character is Leto. Leto is from Barcelona, and he lives in Mexico City and is trying to be an actor. And the roles that he seems to keep on getting are the romantic action hero. The series of movies that he's shooting, his character is called El Caído or something like that. And he seems to have all of these women wanting him, and one of his co-stars, who's a woman, tries to, when he's having when he is erect, she tries to do fellatio to him, and he says, "I would want nothing more, but my heart belongs to another." And when he has his friend Danny with him at the premiere of one of his movies, they seem to be having this nice romantic connection, and we think that it's Danny, but then he's leaving at the end of the night, saying goodnight to Danny. Danny seems to want to take things a little bit further, but he says that line again. And then he gets home, and we find out that Leto is closeted and he has a boyfriend at home. And the relationship that they seem to have seems to be, yes, they love each other, but Hernando is supposed to be a secret. And when that secret is blown, Leto is scared. But as the series progresses and he seems to be more of, if he ever connects, it's largely for comedic purposes. Because he seems to be mostly cut off between from the other members of his cluster, doesn't really do anything with any of his cluster mates until Sun, and it's a really comedic part because they're connecting during a very inopportune part times of her life. Like when she's having her period, or when she's doing the intake interview at prison. And so he has to play it off. And the only real connection that he ever makes is with Nomi Marks. And it's while he's heartbroken because even though Danny does start to expand their horizons, a mistake happens. And Danny has to make it right because Danny's kind of ex-boyfriend Joaquin is still very much infatuated and in love with her. Or, well, probably more infatuated and in lust with her than in love with her. And during a scene, Danny takes pictures of Hernando and Leto having sex, and her boyfriend gets her phone. And he plans to use it to blackmail her. Danny tries to fix it, and her means of fixing it is letting her beat her, him beat her, and marrying him. And Hernando, for him, that's a breaking point. And it's understandable because the entire time, Leto isn't concerned about Danny. He's concerned about his career. Because even though he's gay, and even though he seems to have a real connection with Hernando, he's afraid because if he reveals himself to be gay, he won't get the same parts that he wants. And the entire time, we're wanting to him to have the courage to accept who he is, let the world know who he is, and not care. And Nomi really pushes him a little bit to understand that, and that leads to him having a long period of time of grieving over his relationship and trying to get it back. And then when he connects to Wolfgang, Wolfgang is that just final push that he needs to get out there and to actually fix the problem, which he does in a very spectacular manner. When we first see him trying to fix it, he pulls up and it's kind of like the beginning of one of his movies. Granted, he nearly gets his ass kicked, but he connects with Wolfgang again, and Wolfgang returns the favor. And that is really the biggest growth that Leto has, is even though he understands how the world views who he is, he's understanding that that shouldn't matter, and that what should matter is how he feels and how the people he really truly cares about feel. And so he's taught to open up and to let others know more about him, instead of being only concerned about how to fix things for himself. The next character is Nomi Marks. Nomi is a transgender woman who also is a lesbian who lives in San Francisco. And the biggest role she seems to have is that she is a plot device. She is used to push the plot along. When the connection of the cluster needs to be utilized, it's her that's being used to push along that connection, to make that connection stronger and possible. When they need someone to learn more about what's hunting them, she is used as the catalyst to find out what's going on. And so the biggest growth that she has is learning to utilize her power and learning to connect with other people, because she doesn't seem to have a lot of problems with being a sensate, and she doesn't seem to have a lot of issues utilizing her sensate abilities. But it is necessary for us, the audience, to come to understand being a sensate as much as it is for her and the other sensates to understand what it means to be a sensate. And so Nomi is a very useful means to do so, because she isn't sitting there taking it lying down. She is fighting the entire time. Even though she isn't fighting like Sun is with her fists, she's fighting with her mind and her abilities as a hacker, which comes in handy multiple times, because when we first meet her and start to understand her background, that's how we come to understand her, that she uses technology to let out her experience in the world, and we learn that she was a big hacker, especially back in 2003 when she was starting her journey to becoming a woman. And part of that journey in becoming a woman was an experience she had with her father's old swim club. And she shares that experience with Leto to kind of push him to understand that who he is who he is, and he has to accept that. And he has to not care what the world thinks about it. And by being used as a plot device for hacking in to find out what's going on, hacking in to be used to save members of her cluster, is very useful And she's a very likable character in that she's kind of like Tara from The Walking Dead. What we're thinking is kind of what she's saying. And I like that about her character. Now on to Will Gorski. Will is a cop from Chicago, and he's this leader character who wants to save everyone. One of the first things we learn about him is about Sarah Petrell, and we don't entirely know all of the details. They're interspliced through these dream sequences, and Sarah Petrell is this first thing that was really big for him in how he wanted to help other people, how he wanted to save other people. And this idea of saving other people keeps on coming up. The first sequence we have of him as a cop is he saves a young boy who was shot. And he continuously uses his connection for saving other characters. First member of his cluster that he saves is Naomi Marks from being lobotomized. After connecting with Riley several times, he then saves her from being strangled to death by a drug dealer. And he continuously is used as someone to save other characters, especially in the end when Riley is in trouble and has been found out by the people who are hunting them, their kind. He immediately goes to Iceland to save her without really having a plan, but he goes there knowing that he has to save her, and he's kind of the leader of the cluster because it's his idea to go and fight to save Riley, one of their members. It's his idea to it's kind of his idea to find out what's going on. And of course, Naomi is used again as the catalyst to find out what is going on. But it's his digging, his trying to find out what's going on, that is really the biggest part of his character as a leader and as a protector. And he protects and he saves Cappius a couple of times. First, when he's fighting Superpower the first time, he picks up a gun for Cappius and starts using his training as a police officer with firearms to stop Cappius from being run over by a car. He then uses it again when Cappius is in his big fight scene in the car, big car fight chase scene, to get Cappius a gun so that he can protect himself and protects Cappius from being gunned down by a member of Superpower. And without Will's leadership and protection and protectiveness, that wouldn't be possible for a lot of the characters. He also is one of the two love in internal in intercluster love pairs with Riley. The first time he and Riley look at each other, we can kind of tell that it's a deeper connection than just being two parts of a self. There's a sense of deep connection that we continuously see grow when Riley visits him in his apartment. He talks about the music scene in Chicago and how she should come visit and check it out. And they also talk about their surroundings and where they live. He comments on how beautiful Iceland is and how much her dad seems to care for him and how much her dad seems like a good person. And she comments on how cool it is to live where he how interesting it is where he lives, with all the places he can go and all the sights and sounds that are around him. And of course, there is these several times that they do physically make out. And of course, when Will is saving Riley. When he first touches her, they meet up in person for the first time, they kind of switch places and don't switch places all at the same time. And his willingness to go save her, while yes, they're part of the same cluster, it's almost as if he has to because he can't resist protecting someone he loves. And finally, we have Riley Blue, the Icelandic DJ who lives at the beginning of the series in London, England, and then moves back to Iceland partway through the series. Riley, we always tell that there's something that she's trying to run from that's haunting her. Because every time we see her, she's either got headphones on or is using drugs or something to kind of ease something. And there's a conversation that she has with the drug dealer, Nix, about how he understands her, how she's trying to run. He understands that he empathizes with her. And we keep on seeing her look tortured or sad about something almost all the time in the first half of the series. And when we first go to Iceland, or when we first talk about Iceland, she's apprehensive about going back. And when she talks to Sven, a family friend, about how her father always goes to visit them and how she should go visit them, we're not sure who they are or where they live. And then we start seeing these flashbacks of a car crash. And it's kind of confusing at first, but then we learn that in 2008, she was married and she was pregnant and she had gone into labor. And as her husband was driving her to town, he slid off the road, crashed, bashed his head into the windshield and died. And she gave birth to a daughter that she named Luna. And Luna died. And she was devastated. And one of the most telling lines that we hear from her is that the person who loved him died with him. Granted, the Riley we see still loves him, but the person who she was with him died as well. But that seems to just be an addition to some pain. And we later learn that she connected with another sensate in Iceland named Ursa. And Ursa had told her that she was cursed. And Riley thought that this curse led to her mother, who she cared for deeply, to die. And this kind of set off the catalyst of Riley being the tortured character who needed to get through and understand her demons, which the series does very well, because by the end of the series, it's her connection with Will and her understanding with the two other sensates she meets with, Caphias and Sun, where she really comes to understand that pain exists, but it's there to make us who we are and to cause us to grow, not so much to have us stagnate, which Riley does for a good portion of the season. And with that is the character breakdown of Sensate. Thank you for watching, and stay tuned for more from New Review.